Last year, we did a series of interviews about the experience of the court process for complainants in sexual violence cases. We spoke to lawyers, academics, victim advocates, and we heard the personal stories of victims themselves. In response to a strong sense that aspects of the process re-victimise complainants, the government introduced the Sexual Legislation Violence Bill. That wasn't the only thing that worked there, but that was a significant driver. It passed its first reading in Parliament unanimously, has been through Select Committee, and now has its second reading. But concerns being raised by defence lawyers that the bill undermines a defendant's ability to get a fair trial have seen New Zealand First ask for changes. A couple of things the Nats aren't happy with in Select Committee, and its future without amendments is now uncertain. The campaign against the bill is fairly concerted. One of the lawyers leading it is the co-chair of the Defence Lawyers Association, who is sitting beside me nodding at my intro. Elizabeth Hall is with us now. I should say Jan Logie, who has driven this bill to this point, is going to join us after 7 o'clock to respond to a lot of what you're going to say. Thanks for joining us, Elizabeth.
No, my pleasure.
Do you oppose the bill per se, or do you just oppose part of it? Do you think there is no need for the bill at all?
Okay, can I first start with saying it's not me personally that's just in opposition to this bill. And it's not just defence lawyers that are in opposition to the bill. When the Select Committee stage was on, there were very robust submissions from the New Zealand Law Society, the New Zealand Bar Association, the Criminal Bar Association, the Auckland District Law Society, all who have members of both prosecutors and defence lawyers saying, look, hold fire. There are concerns with the way this bill is drafted. There are concerns with the underlying premise, and we need to rethink.
Right, what are the concerns?
First concern, which is probably the easiest to understand, is the concept that the norm would be pre-recording cross-examination of complainants' evidence.
And there is National Party support that this is problematic from a management point of view.
Yes, and not just political party support for that being problematic, but currently under New Zealand law, it is possible to pre-record a complainant's evidence entirely. But it's used sparingly because of the very real dangers that it carries to fair trial rights. So this is not just lawyers saying this. There's a leading judgment from some of New Zealand's top judges, Justice Glazebrook, now sitting in the Supreme Court, Justice Chambers, unfortunately now deceased, Justice Terence Arnold, former Solicitor General, so top Crown prosecutor, now a Supreme Court judge, saying that this change of pre-recording cross-examination is dangerous. It carries a number of disadvantages. And the biggest risk is that between the time of pre-recording the cross-examination and the actual trial, there will be more information that comes to light that's available that couldn't be put to the complainant, which will mean the complainant has to be re-interviewed, which will undermine the entire purpose of doing it in the first place.
How do we predict the complainant from the kind of things we were hearing about in the interview series that we did in, I think, in May of last year, the sort of stuff that Elizabeth McDonald has been talking about in Rape Myths as Barriers to Fair Trial Process, particularly Chapter 8. Have you read that?
Yes, and can I say this first. There's rape trial myths, and there's also rape trial myths.
Yep.
And I know that there is, commentary about how defence lawyers conduct themselves in court in terms of questioning complainants. And what your interviews didn't drill down on last year, particularly the one with Kirsten Loomis, was, well, if it was being alleged that a defence lawyer acted a certain way, what was the Crown prosecutor doing? What was the judge doing? Because I can tell you
So Kirsten Loomis is a Crown prosecutor, mm-hmm. and she described scenes which I found quite shocking in terms of the cross-examination of a complainant mm-hmm. about her experience, mm-hmm. questions about the bra she was wearing, mm-hmm. whether that implied some form of consent or some kind of form of... Now, isn't this bill a response to this? Doesn't this bill give the judge a right to say to the defence lawyer, stop there?
The judge already has that right. Section 85 of the Evidence Act already says that a judge may stop that type of questioning.
But if you've read Elizabeth McDonald's book, you know, and this is Kirsten Lummis's point, and this is the academics' point, and this is also the point in the Law Society's submission around this, that sometimes the judges don't intervene when they should.
Well, what we also know is that Elizabeth McDonald predominantly considered trials. She looked at 40 trials, predominantly from the years 2010 to 2015. And what we do know, particularly with the advent of the Sexual Violence Court in 2016, that there has been upskilling by defence lawyers, by prosecutors, and importantly, by judges in this area.
But isn't this legislation enshrining a lot of what's happening in the Sexual Violence Court? I mean, isn't this the granting of greater discretion to the judge part of what we're seeing in the Sexual Violence Court?
No, no. In fact, the reverse. The judge already has the discretion to stop unfair questions. What this bill is saying is you can't trust judges to do that. They must do it. And even the New Zealand
Law Society... No, it doesn't say they must do it. They must do it. It
does not. Section 85.
44A1, in a sexual case, unless a judge gives permission.
We're talking about the unfair questioning, not about evidence that's relevant. That's a separate section. The current section is that the judge may stop a question if it's improper or repetitive. This changes it to must. And even the New Zealand Law Society...
So are you saying that they mustn't if it's improper or repetitive? They're both strong words, improper and repetitive.
Yep, but there's a discretion that's available to a judge. And the reason, and the Law Society, the Bar Association, represented by Crown prosecutors at Select Committee, were saying that discretion is appropriate because there will be examples where you can trust a judge that if a question is repetitive, it still should be asked, because the answer may be changing, which is why the question's being repeated. And what this bill is doing is actually saying, we don't trust our judges. And I think that the judges should be very upset that this bill is denigrating the role that they're playing here.
Can we talk to the big issue here? And that is outcomes for categories of adult offences prosecuted to a conclusion in 2018.
Sure.
The lowest conviction rate is sexual assault and related offences.
Okay.
And then if we go to the attrition and progression report from the Ministry of Justice in November of last year, 6% of so there's such a substantial attrition for victimisations that of the cases that were reported to police, only 6% end up with convictions.
Well, I don't agree with that analysis.
Okay, but do you agree with this analysis that says 51% of cases that go to court end up with convictions, the lowest rate of any offence?
Okay, three comments. One, that doesn't mean that the criminal justice system is failing. The only way that the criminal justice system can work is if juries are empowered with all relevant information and can decide whether it's met.
No one's saying it's failing. People are just saying it could be better.
By better, you mean more convictions?
Well, a bit fairer.
Well, that's not the same thing as more convictions, is it? And that's a critical issue here.
So why, as a defence lawyer, and this is a really important question, and I'll listen to the answer, why is the rate of conviction for sexual assault cases lower than for all these other crimes listed?
All right. Because often sexual assault happens behind closed doors. It happens often without any sign, forensic sign, any sign of violence, any sign of bruising or injuries or marks. It often happens without witnesses. It certainly often happens without CCTV cameras or recording. Other crimes do happen with those factors. So it's understandable that where it's a he said, she said, or a he said, he said, or, two people telling different accounts of the same incident, that it's understandable that juries have to err on the side of caution. Okay. That is their responsibility.
Final question. Are you saying chuck it out, or are you saying there are tweaks we would accept? And tweaks is a glib word. There are changes, amendments we would accept that would see this being a good piece of law.
Look, the two main changes are the pre-recorded cross-examination that has to go,
yep,
and also the concept of relevant evidence, which is currently admissible, which would be inadmissible under this bill.
OK, relevant evidence. And if those two things went, would you support it?
There are still other wording changes that need to happen, but that would go a long way to calming the concern of both prosecutors, defence lawyers, overseas commentators about the bill.
Right, I will put that to Jan Logie, who's joining us after the news. Elizabeth Hall, thank you so much for coming in this morning. We really appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Thank you.